In today's video, I'm going to be chatting with my fantastic colleague, Ed. Hi, Ed. How are you?
Hello. I'm not too bad at all. Thank you very much. How are you?
Very well, thank you. It looks like you're about to be leading some airlines in for for landing. Sounds very
good. If an aircraft comes crashing through the window, I've just forgotten my primary duties for the benefit of this recording. Hopefully not. We're safe for a while.
So today we're not here to discuss how to land planes. We are here to discuss adapting your market. In any organisation, you can plan to target a certain type of audience subject to their wants and needs. But we also need to make sure and be aware that we're always keeping an eye on our customers and they might change. So I've invited Ed to come on for a chat today and chat about the opportunity. If your audience has completely changed, first of all, how can you identify it? And second of all, how should you adapt your marketing and what should you do? So, Ed, let's kick off with the first question, being my current target audience has completely changed. What should I do?
Well, if you're going to fall in line with most people, there is an element of panic around that. But I think it's a fairly natural part of business. Audiences do change. I remember, if you consider Facebook even, started out, had a very kind of teenage, early 20s-centric audience that has grown up with it, and they've realized that their business model had to adapt and change over time to an audience that was new to social media because they were approaching mid-teens, but didn't want to join Facebook because for them, that was very much 5 years ago, 10 years ago. And for many businesses, that adaptability takes place over time. It can often be foreseen. But such is the situation we're facing at the moment, for example, as this is recorded in the middle of the coronavirus pandemic, there are some things we absolutely cannot plan for. And I think actually this goes back to how we adapt and engage with our audiences in the first place. So for me, there has to be a foundation stone to this. And the foundation stone is by having a fan base. Arguably, if we have an audience that isn't truly engaged with who we are, they might buy from us and there might be a sense of loyalty to a point, although this is 2020 and loyalty is a tougher purchase. But if we don't have that level of engagement, that fan base, that tribe through our the work that we do through the communication and through our digital engagements with our audience, then effectively, when we're required to pivot because we have this completely unpredictable scenario, we're effectively starting from scratch again. We don't have the leverage that we need to convert that audience, but we need to look back at, okay, who is our target audience and how do we engage with them? Arguably, like we were starting a business from scratch in the first place. The other side of that is if we do have a loyal fan base, and if we do have a loyal fan base who is engaged with what we do, who love what we do, but we're forced to change, then they're the best people to connect with those who we're now working towards. So one prime example of this was there's a chap called Neil Baradwa. He runs the Cambridge Fruit Company. And about the early stages of the coronavirus pandemic, he put a call out. So he only provided to commercial businesses. That's all he did. There was just a sufficient market there for him, and that's where his focus point was. But of course, the lockdown came into place and everyone was told to work from home, and his business just stopped. And he had never historically looked, apart from a bit of early research, had never considered going into the domestic market. But now he was forced to. But he had a fan base who loved what he did, who loved the stories of what the stories he was telling on social media. So whether they bought from him historically or not, or whether they hadn't bought from him but were totally bought into who he was and everything that he conveyed. Actually, now there were people who go, I've always worked from home, I don't have your needs. And of course, now when people are stuck at home and only going out for essential purchases, if you can bring fruit and veg to my door, I am your audience. And all those people suddenly were recommending him to all the people based at home, had a whole new audience to recommend him to. And he's now in a stage where he can't take any more orders on. But his entire market has pivoted by 180 degrees. It's like So Professor Robert Dunbar did this once before. He concluded, he's an anthropologist at Oxford University, and concluded that we all have interpersonal relationships with about 150 people. And of course, each of them have interpersonal relationships with 150 people. So you're two handshakes away from an audience of 20,000 plus. If that 150 people that you're connected with, your target audience, are now suddenly no longer your target audience, then they're your leverage to the 150 people they each know who become your target audience. And that comes from how much they love you in the first place. And that comes from so much of the organic content that we can provide through email newsletters, through social media, and more as well, and through the content that we produce.
Yeah. And I think you've given a number of useful examples there. And the most, they're all important, but one that you've touched on, which I wanted to highlight as well, is a lot of the social networks have started in one way and ended up in another, haven't they? You've touched on Facebook. Instagram was another one. It was originally set up for photographers, and actually practically all of us are on Instagram now, and they never went out with that intention. And House Party was meant for a younger audience. And I chatted to my accountant this morning, and he's not in the younger age bracket by any shape or form. And he had a house party with his 80-year-old mother for his birthday. Like, that was not what House Party intended, but it's almost consumer-driven marketing, isn't it? Around, you know, if consumers want something, they will go and find it. And it's up to you as a business if you want to embrace that or say, no, I want to stick to my target audience of commercial businesses, and I'm just going to shut my business down during a difficult time. Or actually, what is that demand, and is there a demand, and how can I pivot my business? And the examples you've given there is a fantastic example, and there's loads more out there when we care to go and look for them, aren't there?
There are. Let's not get started about the house party thing. I'm 46 years old. It's taken me several attempts to get to grips with this, which reminds me of when the CEO of Snap, the company behind Snapchat, was asked by a journalist. I don't find the UI of Snapchat particularly easy. Why is that? CEO said, "How old are you?" "Well, I'm 42. "Well, you're not my target audience then." It was a very valid point. And I think we have to, there's two sides when our audience grows up with us. Do we go with them on the journey and accept that this change happens and our business needs to adapt to that audience? Or do we then kind of wave our audience on its merry way while we try and look for that whole new audience, of which the demands of that audience are different to the demands of the original audience when they were at that younger age themselves? Because when Facebook started, it was Facebook, MySpace, Bebo, and that was pretty much it. And now there's so many more social networks out there with, I believe, many, many more to be produced over the next even kind of 2 to 3 years. So that audience has to change. And we can't all be like Facebook. We can't just say, right, when everyone's on WhatsApp, fine, we'll buy WhatsApp. It doesn't work quite so much. But then that goes back to part of it is, how much do we listen to our audience? How much do we make assumptions based on our figures, our data, our turnover, without actually trying to converse with those who regularly buy from us to understand how much of those needs that they have we're serving in the first place, and how they see us as opposed to how we think they should see us. It's like the number of businesses who will look at their SEO data to find out what people are searching for to put into Google, but we don't know the context behind that search. We don't know what people are thinking when they find us, and so we make too many assumptions on that. And I think we have to, because even at this stage now, there are many businesses who are thriving. I almost said the words benefiting from the situation we're in, and I don't mean that in a cold-hearted way, quite the opposite. It's just that many businesses are in a situation where they've become busier as a result of everyone working from home. And you mentioned House Party, Zoom being another prime example of a platform that's benefiting hugely from everyone working from home. But every business is going to go through this at some point in the future. So we need to adapt with our fans now. And when the coronavirus is over now, those businesses who have boomed as a result of it, then how are they going to be impacted by the traffic that's now no longer there? How many of the audiences that we get from this are we turning into fans and understanding why they're there and what they want from us and planning our future journeys to kind of minimize the risk of the need to pivot, which will hit us all at some point.
Yeah. And absolutely, the example you gave earlier around the company that's pivoted, you know, a whole 180 from doing commercial fruit and veg delivery to consumer fruit and veg delivery, what he's actually done is, you know, he's pivoted to demand, but actually now he's created an even bigger and better business, because I guess because of his loyal fan base, and he had a sustainable business beforehand, and obviously because of coronavirus it has fallen over, but actually when business comes back he'll have two pieces of the pie, won't he? Because he'll have his consumer base and his business base, and actually some of those consumers might work in other businesses, and because he's done such a great job he might pick up more business off the back of that as well.
Absolutely, huge platform for growth. And actually there was one wonderful example where one of his clients, obviously their office is closed like so many, hopefully only temporarily, and has said, look, you know, we want to continue with the relationship with you, so keep providing us with fruit and veg, it's just send it to this particular NHS centre or hospital or surgery instead of us, but invoice us for it as well. And again, it's kind of wonderful stories from this, but this, you know, we know this, we do this all the time, where we get the businesses to talk about why they do what they do, and what is the driver behind that, and using the platforms that we can communicate on and tell our story and actually kind of drive our audience's stories to us too, to say, well, actually, you know, be part of our journey. We want to be part of your journey, because our journeys are inevitably going to change. And then we can hit each other when we get to it. And people buy from people. How many times have we heard that line? But this is a great example to do that now. It's never too late. Even when you're experiencing, you're in the midst of that forcing to change your audience, then it's never been more important at that point to get to the heartbeat of who that audience really is. And you know, we look at even the big organizations, the you know, the Coca-Colas and Innocents of this world, they'll have campaigns throughout their time that specifically communicate to segmented audiences, because it's that right time of year to do so. We look at health centers that will target the elderly and vulnerable for flu jabs in December. They're not ignoring everyone else. It's just that's the heartbeat of our campaign. And it's right to do that, but it's right to kind of truly kind of engage with them at the same time, rather than just pick an audience and broadcast to them, this is what we're doing and this is right for you, but get more from them so that, you know, we can, and if we're in a situation where we're pivoting now, then it's all important to find who the epicenter of your audience is and just start having conversations with them.
Yeah. And I was just going to say exactly that. I work with large businesses and small businesses, much like you do, when we're doing training and working with clients. And that's the thing I love about small businesses. It, you know, they really genuinely normally get their customers, where the bigger businesses, they'll go, oh, our customer is just ABC One profile or male 24 has a car. That adds no context. That's just data, isn't it? So smaller businesses generally have the data and the context because they talk to their clients on a daily basis. So if I was a small business today, or even a mid-sized business, or even a global business, to be fair, and my business had disappeared overnight, what would you recommend business owners or marketing directors do to try and understand what the opportunities might be in the first instance?
I think, you know, the first area is to look where businesses are, where the opportunities do lay. And I think if you take the example of the platform that we're using now to communicate, you know, on one hand, it dramatically changed, but it hugely grew at the same time to a whole new audience. But whether this audience is sustainable or not for the model that it currently has, I don't know, because there's a good chance we're all going to leave it when we're all going back to our offices and having more face-to-face communications. But of course, if that foresight has been taken away from you, then we need to firstly look at and kind of go back to building almost from scratch to say, right, what have we learned about our audience so far? Because that audience bought from us, that audience engaged with us, that audience knew who we were. How have their needs changed? Because when we understand how their needs change, we can adapt to where their needs currently are now. Because they're still the same people. They're still the same people who have the same emotions about our brand. So when we adapt to their lives, then we create a potential new opportunity as well. The other side of it is to do what we can do now to as leverage for future work. So on one hand, it's right, okay, let's take stock, let's put a plan together, let's, you know, kind of throw some ideas around over the next month or so, and then let's relaunch. But for me, that opportunity is an entirely wasted opportunity. So you see organizations now that are putting out a huge amount of even free content in an opportunity to continue to be visible, so that when that change in direction has been more formalized and kind of laid out there for your fans to see, you've not suddenly just returned out of being distant or on return from a holiday. You've constantly been there, constantly been engaging with them, constantly helping them through their challenges, and at a point now where they're still part of the journey and you're still part of their lives as well, so that when you make that change, that pivot becomes, I think, an easier understanding for them, your audience, to follow. Because while we disappear, our competitors will be looking to service their needs as well. I think being visible is a pretty integral part of this, even if it means producing free content. And I know that sticks in the throat of many organizations, but if your opportunity is to do nothing while you work in the back end of changing your organization, or producing free content while you're working at the back end of the organization to produce a new direction, then option B has got to be the more favorable option, because you're less likely to be forgotten by your audience. Loyalty doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah. And absolutely, and there's lots of examples out there where, you know, businesses are pulling all of their marketing teams are going on furloughed leave, which is fine. I understand why they're doing that, but their visibility is going to disappear overnight, and that means that they're going to have to work so much harder when their market does come back. And actually, like you've said, if some of their competitors are still doing their marketing in the background, just reminding them that they're there, giving them hints and tips, entertaining, educating, inspiring them for when that market does come back, even while they're planning to pivot the market or change altogether or just wait for it to come back, there's only going to be one winner in this, really, isn't there?
Oh, we know this already, because we see the likes of Joe Wicks doing he's the nation's PE teacher. Yeah. He doesn't need a microphone, just open your front door, you can hear him shout from wherever he is. But he's the nation's PE teacher. David Walliams, who does his free ebook every day for the younger audiences. And there are so many more examples of people doing this, because they know their audiences have become more strapped for cash, or they know their audiences have changed. They know their audiences, take the example of both those that I gave you, Joe Wicks and David Walliams, that actually they need assistance for the parents who are now teachers. And I'm still learning to be a parent, despite my kids being 12 and 6. I'll continue to learn to be a parent.
Google's I've never great for that. Even it's every day.
And now I've got to learn to be a teacher as well. I mean, it's so the people who are providing this free content, when whatever the new normal looks like, at the other side of this, we're going to look back at these brands with a far more favorable memory, and therefore kind of desire to take those opportunities to consume their stuff. I'm going to buy David Walliams' book. Actually, he's my standout guy because of what happened. There is, round the corner from where I am, a small shop who has small hand gel bottles, who are selling them at £8-9 a pot. And it's taking advantage of a situation to say, we've got them, but we want your money for it. But consumers will remember this, because when we come out the other side of this, people do have memories that go, but you tried to stitch us up when we needed you. And I think that shops like that will struggle. So we need to work on actually how we can go with our audience, how we can help them through this economical and emotional kind of trauma that we're all experiencing in different ways, and address what their needs are now, so that, as I said already, when we come out of this, they're going to look at us to say, you help me, and I'm going to, the law of reciprocity, the unwritten rule in the back of our minds, is going to mean then that I'm going to help you. And whether that's by spreading the message of you, even if I'm no longer your target audience, or talking about you more favorably to my peers and friends and family, or whether it is even just buying your products or service, it's going to happen because you've been with me through my troubled times too.
Yeah. And I think linked to those points you've made, there's a number of things in there around influence. So influence is hugely powerful. It's been, you know, influence has been around since human beings have been around. And you touched on it earlier around, we're only two handshakes away from 25,000 people. Because we are all isolated, we're talking now more than ever. And if you're a parent, we're not necessarily moaning all the time, but we're juggling being a parent and doing work, and how our Tasmanian devils are running. Well, my Tasmanian devil, 2-year-old, is running around the house. So we talk about how to keep them entertained. So yeah, Joe Wicks actually gets mentioned in, you know, conversations. So does David Walliam. So does a book that I love reading to my son. The author there, Benji Davies, has been doing like live Instagram feeds with his reading his book as well. So that power of influence and the empathy and the human side is more important than ever, but it's being driven by social media and the brands, and whether those brands are the small corner shop. I know you mentioned that example to me last week. You know, that's gone in. Not that I live in Cambridge, but you're telling people about what a bad, you know, that person's trying to profiteer too much. Like, if they sold it at a regular price, absolutely, there's a need for it. But don't overcharge for something when people really need it. They're going to remember that for the wrong reason, but they'll also remember the good stuff for the right reasons as well. So all of that, you know, people are buying from people at the end of the day. And even big brands like, you know, Wagamama's or, you know, Joe Wicks, he's a big brand at the end of the day. People will remember that sort of stuff. And because they are empathetic and they understand the challenges that we're having right now, whether you are a business or a consumer, you're a human being at the end of the day. And it's understanding that human challenge and how that person can be helped, isn't it, at the end of the day?
There's Facebook page called Stay at Home Football Coaching. So it's a dad who also kind of is a grassroots football coach. In fact, he never, apart from the odd image in the post, so every Tuesday and Thursday evening, he does stay at home football coaching, which is indoors. You don't need a huge amount of space. It's about kind of, and it's aimed at kids kind of at all ages. It's about getting the ball moving between your feet. I don't have a huge amount of space in this here, but in this room, but we could easily do it in here, kind of thing. And he does it every week, and he has thousands of people tuning in live, which of course they could also watch afterwards because the recording is saved. Now just imagine that a football brand had seen that opportunity and had equally done it more in, you know, again in a selfless way, in a here have this information, here have this and it could be a manufacturer of sports goods, or it could be, you know, someone who sells online football coaching or, you know, products, sport related products, and just says, right, here is just some stuff you can do at home. Because there's, and if that brand had done it and not emblazoned it with their brand and stuff, but had just kind of taken that same, or sees that same opportunity, then when we come out the other side of this, then again, they'll be thought of in a more fun fashion. And using the example of the profiteering, I remember this happening exactly back in, oh crikey, must have been about 20 years ago now, or the best part of, when fuel was about 85 pence a litre. That's how far back we're going here. And we had the fuel strike. I don't know if you remember this.
Yeah.
When lorries were kind of parked in front of the refinery plants. And there was one, I lived in North London at the time, and there was one petrol station who said, we've got fuel, but we're going to sell it at like £1 a litre. Now, we'd laugh at that now, but I'm going back to the days where it was like 80, 85 pence a litre. They say, we've got it, but we're going to sell it over £1 a litre. Now, people had to go there because their own local petrol station was running out because deliveries weren't making it. So people thought, right, okay, reluctantly, begrudgingly, I'm going to have to go and fill up, and I'm going to have to do it here. But within months of the fuel strike being lifted, they went out of business because people made a point of not going there, and people made a point of driving further past them to the next petrol station because they didn't try and profiteer from the misfortune that we were all suffering. And again, you know, it's not a case of it's one or the other. It's not a case of provide something free or overcharge for it. Often it's just about being part of the conversation for our needs of our audiences now. And if we can see our business changing, then while we're putting together an idea of where our audience is changing to, then we need to start those conversations now for whenever we're ready to target them with the right products and services.
Yeah, yeah. And I think it's interesting how social media and internet, like, it's a luxury at the end of the day. We didn't need social media before, did we? It was more of a luxury. It was more of a want than a need. And we were always being told off for being on social media too much, where now it is a need. It's a need for us to communicate with, you know, your mum and your dad and your grandparents and all that type of stuff. So it means that we've almost forced people into this online position. So like you've said, you know, Zoom has got more traffic than ever before, and they're providing a free, you know, a free tool for a lot of people. So from a business point of view, it's a huge opportunity. Whether your audience has changed or not, you can garner all of this data because they're almost all of your audience is forced online at the moment. So the language they use, what they're using, and you know, we've already touched on this, how House Party was created for one audience and actually now it's another. People, you know, you can learn so much from people's behavior. So looking at your Google Analytics to see what they're interested in, looking at Google Search Console to see what's interesting and what isn't, looking at Google Trends, and like you say, picking up the telephone and talking to your clients, your potential clients, listening on social media to see what their wants and needs are. Because I think when you work in your own sector, it's easy to assume that people know things. Like, I've known about Zoom for years, I've known about Skype for years because we've been doing training online for years. But when we first went into coronavirus, there was a couple of training companies that we worked with and they'd never done online training, and they rang us and spoke to Evie and said, you guys do online training, how do you do it? And we helped them. I think Evie spent an hour on the phone to each of them. And I was like, if those training companies don't know how to do it, how many other training companies are out there that need that help? So I was like, well, let's help them. Let's do a free webinar, because yes, I know it, but it's amazing. You can't assume that your other, you know, audiences and suppliers and customers know it as well. So that huge bit of listening is really powerful to then give them that help to then support them in the future and help them get over these pickles that they may have and be able to get them up and running again.
No, absolutely. Sorry, bear with me. BA flight 257, get clear for takeoff. Yep. But there's 3 points there. I often come across businesses, and I'm sure you do too, who focus too much on the data and not enough on the human touch points. So we and that's right to do so. You know, Google Analytics gives us so much value. Google Trends gives us so much value in understanding, you know, kind of what we're doing right and what we need to do better. But it is as simple as picking up the phone to those who are our greatest fans and understanding from them. But I think the other thing that stood out from what you just said then is the collaborative effect as well. So now more than ever, we need to work together. We need to find it could be that we don't have, now we're being forced to pivot because the needs of our audience has changed. We maybe don't have everything we need to satisfy the needs of our new target audience. So rather than just a customer supplier relationship, who can we collaborate with to now, you know, to deal with those needs that benefits us both? Because again, when we come out of this, and maybe it's just as simple as our audiences go back, or whether there's a third level to this because of a new normal that's going to come out of the other side of this or any other situation, then we'll both be able to provide the leverage for that future stage of growth, whether it's together or whether it's just a natural case of spreading the good message about the people we work with. But often collaborative opportunities are not sourced as efficiently as they should be, and we see, well, we haven't got the skill set to do that, so let's see where else we can do it, which I think is so often a missed opportunity.
Yeah, absolutely. And there's lots of opportunities out there in terms of, you know, businesses changing and pivoting what they're up to. And I think just a key for businesses to think about if they are pivoting and changing is they might suddenly get really busy. So like the veg guy that you've talked about, he might suddenly get really busy with consumers. But if he wants it to be sustainable, like, don't just go and deliver the orders. You know, make sure you're getting them on your email database, make sure you're getting them on your social media channels, but so they can still remember you and you can still keep marketing them when things do go back to normal and they don't suddenly forget about you. Because, you know, with the nicest will in the world, you might be a great guy, but suddenly people go back into their own routines of going to the big supermarkets every week, which I don't do. I support my local farm shop, and at the moment I'm desperate to support my local farm shop, but they don't do delivery and I can't even do click and collect, and I can't even ring them to order because they just don't have the resources. So I've had to go to the next farm shop up the road, which is it's a local farm shop as well. And they've gone from famine of not a lot of business at all to more veg box deliveries and more veg box click and collect than they've ever had. And I obviously want to go and pick my veg up because I don't want to take the deliveries away from the people that really need them. But I can't order online. I had to ring 26 times. But because I am a loyal fan to a local farm shop, I have persisted. But many other people wouldn't.
How many?
Have gone to the big supermarket because it's the easy get at. And I'm like, no, I refuse to support a big supermarket. You know, my needs and wants are with the local businesses because they want my business and I want to give it to them consistently. But you're making it really hard for me at the minute.
Yeah. No, absolutely. And I think, you know, even sometimes making those changes for, so I've come across many businesses who are saying, we're not able to take your call at the moment because we're closed, or we're not able to take your call because of the sheer volume in traffic, please email us. But is that a solution? Or is it, you can also find us on social media, or please try us through these methods? I don't think we often feel right. We now need to forget those people and put all our attentions here. But those people we're forgetting, and I'm pretty sure, no matter how good your nearest farm shop is, that you're the only person that will persist 26 times in trying to get hold of them, that there are many people who have given up and have gone, well, I tried, but I'm going to go now to one of the larger supermarkets and try with them instead. Which even they're having their own issues in terms of stock availability and delivery slots too. So I think we need to kind of pull the different touch points we have with our audiences together, rather than just going, well, that's not working, let's focus all our attentions here. And using the fruit and the Cambridge Fruit Company as the option, yes, he's continuing to engage with the audiences that he had, the fans he had. He's building a new fan base, because there are many people who are saying, this is great, thank you very much. There are smiles still on their faces when they come to deliver. The efficiency levels aren't impacted by this. They have a new working regime that keeps employees safe and respects them, but allows them obviously to all work, which is fantastic. So therefore also saving the state pot as well. For their pennies, but also there, every time someone comments, there's that response to it. There's a constant need to, and the advantage for him and the advantage for so many small businesses is he's the focal point for this. Now, I genuinely believe if he decided to sell the business would probably dramatically decline, because he is such a focal point for this. And I know that that in itself can become a tough thing for businesses to want to do, because they don't want to be in the limelight. But using the people who are kind of getting through this, showing what your staff are up to, whether it's at home in calls like this, or as much as you do when you take photographs of us when we have our team chats and such, and when you're talking on LinkedIn about what you're, you know, what the team's up to over this week and where we're still delivering training courses, but telling the stories of the people who are still working, who are working behind the scenes, if they're physically working in a space together, then again sharing images so people can visualize what that's like in their own world, because we're now not only in an opportunity to tell our story better, because so many, well, actually it is because everyone's now at home on social media, everyone's now at home reading, watching, listening, so we have to produce the content that stands above all the other people who are just saying, I'm now online, buy from me, I'm now online, here's my product, here's my service, here's our people, here's what we're doing, here's the impact our service is having on others. And when we do that, our head successfully sticks above the parapet and people remember us for it.
Yeah, absolutely. And one final thing, just to wrap up, you've shared a great, huge amount of tips today. Thank you. But I know Amazon has caused problems with people. We talked about big brands like, you know, the supermarkets are struggling, but actually so is Amazon. Obviously, Amazon is only taking delivery of real essential items at the moment, fulfillment. So there'll be some organizations out there that had been selling very successfully through Amazon, and now they can't get their products into Amazon to out. So their audience may have completely changed as well as such. So I think it's probably just worth highlighting that, and I know that we always talk about this at Social B, of, you know, you want to get people onto your website, get their email databases, their email into your database, obviously GDPR friendly and abiding by all of the rules, absolutely, because social media and other channels like Amazon is rented space at the end of the day, and we never know, you know, they're absolutely got the biggest audiences and we should absolutely be on them, but they are rented space and you don't own it. And obviously Amazon controls the purse strings and who sees what and who takes control of what. So there has been businesses that have literally had the carpet pulled under them overnight.
No, and this is the disingenuous line that so many claim. I want to use social media to sell more products. I want to use Amazon to sell more products. And where Amazon is a site to buy from, social media isn't. Social media, there are opportunities through Facebook, for example, and through advertising, of course, but it's only a vehicle to take you to the relevant page that you can actually buy that product or service. And if that is to another third-party site, then yeah, you're absolutely missing the trick. So social media isn't the site to sell on. Social media is a site to engage on, but to get you to that point. So I think the emphasis has got to be so much. It doesn't matter what you sell, where you sell it. You've got to have a front door that you own and you control. Because when you don't, you rely on other people's decisions when the expected and unexpected happens. And, you know, I don't think and hope that we never experience an unexpected change in society as much as this. But you're right, it doesn't have to be a bells and whistles website. It can be a very kind of simple key message front door for who you are and how people can get in touch with you. Or it can be, actually, these are the essential products, but we're selling them here. We're selling them at the same price. We're dispatching them fine. We might not be able to dispatch them at the same speed of which Amazon could, but we can still get them to you, and we'll prioritize our delivery to those who are in greater need. But yeah, you've got to have your own front door. And when you do have your own front door, the ways that we can drive traffic to that front door are so endless, through emails, through newsletters, through blog content, through videos, podcasts, social media content, all driving to that front door that people then become familiar with is an opportunity that needs to start now. Doesn't matter where you are in that journey of pivoting or success or what you might deem failure at the moment, there is never a better time to ensure your front door is visible.
Yeah, absolutely. And that front door is then, you would then have your own control, don't you? I was talking to an influencer, Marion, who we've got on another video. We were talking, she's a photography and travel influencer, and I was talking to her around how obviously her market's changed and how brands can work with her. And we were talking about a traditional garden centre that she'd been talking with. And they were like, yeah, we want to get online, we want to have a website, but we need it to link with our EPOS system and we need it to link to our stock system and blah. And they've been taking months. And then coronavirus hits and suddenly they're like, oh my goodness, we've lost all our business. We need to get that website up and running in 24 hours. There is never too late to get your stock on your website. You can, you know, we can build websites and websites can be built in 24 hours, even with your essential stock. But the moment you create that front door, it allows people to be able to find your product and your service, and you can change your signposting and email your database and get people to purchase online rather than having that rented space, whether it be Amazon or businesses that do sell through Instagram. I know lots of businesses that sell through Instagram, and when Instagram's gone down for a few hours, they're literally losing thousands every minute in money and revenue.
But even when we're not in a situation like this, in you know, business as usual situations, you have your target audience. Amazon are selling for you, whether you're a farm shop or a garden center, you have your demographic of audience that comes in. But by having sufficient digital front door as well, then you're even then opening up the opportunities to new audiences, to millennials who don't want to go out and to browse in the same way that potentially older customers do. So rather than not provide them with an opportunity to buy from you and send them somewhere else, encourage them to come to you as well as the audience that's buying from you. So it's not a case of pivoting your audience, or not a case of having an entirely different audience. It's about taking the audience you've got as well and building on that, so that when whatever business looks like in a year's time, 5 years time, 10 years time, we're continually developing and dealing with their needs. And I think we know this all the time. If you just do nothing, then your business will eventually decline. There's no guaranteed success in the future. So when you have your own controlled website, your domain, your shop, you're in far greater control.
And just to finish on that Amazon side of things, again, just linked to our team talking in the office, or not in the office, obviously in our home offices, a few of them were after yoga mats. And typically, you know, we're all Amazon buyers. Like, we go on Amazon, one click collect, and we buy not because of the price, because of the convenience of one click and we get it tomorrow. But of course, that model is totally flawed at the moment. And I think it was Evie was talking about buying a yoga mat, and she went on Amazon and it wasn't going to be delivered for 3 weeks. So she was like, well, that doesn't work. I don't need it. So she was trawling the internet to try and get a yoga mat for the next day or the next day after that. And so she was searching all over the internet for it. So the Amazon model is sort of broken at the moment. So Amazon's audience is changing, and people are moving to help get their want and need of delivery next day or delivery in a couple of days rather than in a few weeks. So it's so fascinating. And I learn all of this much like you because I just listen so much. I listen and I don't just take it in terms of, oh, she wants a yoga mat. I'm like, their behavior of how they're using the internet and what, you know, what their wants and needs are. And, you know, Charlotte buying pasta online and, you know, spending more money online now more than ever because they're like, well, we're at home so much and I miss my nice coffee. So I want a coffee machine, which I'd have never wanted before. So I just find all of that really fascinating and then linked to the, you know, the why and the humanizing and the empathy. So I think there's a lot of, you know, at the end of the day, I think the thing that you and I have both agreed on today and both succinct with is listening. You've got amazing headphones on and they're the perfect thing to listen to a lot of things is listening to people, listening to people, what they're saying on social media, listening to just general conversation of our parents and our friends when we're talking to them, just listening about their wants and their needs and how they're digesting content and what their needs are in terms of what they need at home and how their businesses are adapting. And then using that in terms of data collection for helping us to pivot our businesses or slightly change them or change them completely.
40% of active Twitter users don't tweet. So they're clearly on there listening to the conversations that are taking place that interest them, whatever the topic is about. Now, whereas I don't know the data for the other channels, I can't believe that it's dramatically different. In fact, I suspect that it's probably higher in some of the other channels than it is on Twitter. So that alone just goes to show how much information. There's 1.3 million groups on LinkedIn where you can kind of observe many of the conversations that are taking place. There are over 10 million groups on Facebook of people conversing about such a collection of needs, wants, and topics and interests. So there's so much data out there for consuming whatever situation is now, no matter how busy you are, you're in an environment now where you've got the opportunity to do that and to learn from them. So it's picking up the phone to the people who are fans. It's sending emails and getting user-generated content from those who already love us. But it's also listening to the wider world and seeing what they're talking about and what is influencing their decisions that can direct us or help us direct us to the place we should be going. And of course, if you need directions, then come to air traffic control and I'll help you.
Yeah, and I totally agree with that in terms of social media because I post on LinkedIn quite a lot, much like you do, and I do get interaction on my posts. But then when I go traditional networking, when I was allowed out of my house, I would always get a few people coming up to me and saying, oh, I love your posts of, you know, where you put your laptop, you know, when I was able to travel. Oh, I love seeing where you put your laptop each week. And I thought, well, you've never engaged with me on social media, but they're all listening. And I've had the same on Twitter, the same on Facebook. I call them Facebook stalkers on Facebook, you know, family and friends just listen. They don't post anything. And then you'll go around your mum's for a cup of tea and she'll say, blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, how do you know that? Oh, my dad saw it on your dad saw it on Facebook. You know, they are just listening, not necessarily engaging it. And they're using it to digest content. And I think businesses can absolutely learn so much from that, should they choose, shouldn't they?
And of course, if they're not sure how, then get in touch. It goes without saying. But yeah, there's so much conversation out there, which arguably means there's a lot of noise out there too. And you have to find a way to kind of wade your way through it. But often that comes through confidence and experience.
Yeah, yeah. Excellent. Okay. Well, thank you so much for the chat today. I hope the airline landed very safely. Are there any last tips that you want to share, Ed?
The one that I seem to be saying more often than not at the moment, it doesn't matter what size of business you are, it doesn't matter how busy or quiet you are, it doesn't matter where you are on the journey or what this has impacted, or even what industry you're in, or whether you're local or national or international. But now, more than ever, it's critical to be visible with your fans through email marketing, through social media marketing, through content creation. So if I was to just give one tip, it's be visible.
Yeah, excellent. Okay, well, thank you for your time today. It's been great to chat to you and speak to you soon.
I look forward to it. Thanks for having me.